The beauty of listed real estate is the fact that it is a real, tangible asset, and you can peg value within the private markets.
Joining me today is Laurel Durkay, Managing Director, Head of Global Listed Real Assets, and Global and U.S. Portfolio Manager with Morgan Stanley. Laurel, you participated on two panels here at REITwise. The first one focused on REIT M&A. What do you think was the key contributor to the heavy volume of activity we saw last year? And do you think it's likely to continue in 2022?
There was a number of different factors at play that really did come to a head in 2021. If you sort of take a step back and look at what unfolded between 2019 and 2022, year to date, there's been $127 billion of REIT M&A that has been announced, and that's in about 20 deals, so $6.3 billion average size per deal. And again, there was a number of different factors at play that led to that increase volume of M&A that really happened in 21. So first is the fact that there's a significant amount of dry powder on the sidelines that has been raised to be deployed into real estate. There's about $400 billion at the beginning of 21, and really there's still about $400 billion on the sidelines now. And then there is this, the second point is that the value discrepancy between the public markets and the private markets. The beauty of listed real estate is the fact that it is a real, tangible asset, and you can peg value within the private markets. And what you had seen really coming out of the pandemic was that there was a big discrepancy between valuations within the private markets and the public markets. Arguably, the private markets did need to compress a little bit more than they had, but the public markets overshot, and it was creating arbitrage opportunity for different capital allocators across the board. And then the third piece that I think really came to a head in 21 was the fact that we were at this inflection point of a recovery in fundamentals. Everyone knows that vintage year is very important on the buy. You need to get a good basis in order to get your IRR. And we were at a point in time where these fundamentals were positively inflecting. And so that led to an increased number of investors looking to deploy into listed real estate. I think when you look at all of those factors, a lot of them are still at play for 2022. So you still have valuation support. You still have this continued fundamental recovery. And then the third piece that you didn't have as pronounced in 21, but that certainly is pronounced in 22, is this inflationary environment that we're all living in and the inflation protection that listed real estate really can provide for investors across the board that could help fuel additional transaction activity this year.
The other panel you were focused on here dealt with corporate governance. How important do you think issues like climate risk and human capital management are to institutional investors when they're looking at REITs?
They are very important, and it's not just that they're important to institutional investors, they are important to all stakeholders. So what you're seeing really come to a head is the fact that capital allocators are looking at ESG issues, tenants are looking at ESG issues, and governments are looking at ESG issues. And so it is really important for the REITs across the board to really start prioritizing this. I mean, one of the things that I really believe we all need to do is focus on transparency and reporting as an industry for environmental, social, and governance issues, key risks, and opportunities.
When you look at the US REIT market, what do you think is going to be the most compelling investment story over the next year?
So I think that the one that I am really excited about right now is within the retail space. For the last decade, almost, you saw retail being a dirty word within real estate investing, whether it was private or public. And certainly what you've seen coming out of the pandemic is that has changed. And there's been an increased focus on omnichannel distribution and the fact that the physical storefront really does play an important part and an important role in that distribution of goods to the end consumer.
Okay, and how about on a global standpoint? What do you think will be the most compelling story there?
From a global perspective, I think the retail thing is also playing out globally, which is really interesting. You're beginning to see value stabilization in Europe, in Australia, in other parts of Asia. That's really important. But even more interesting from a global perspective, I think, is office real estate. Because what you're seeing in office right now is that COVID was a mass scale test case in work from home capabilities. And I really do believe you will see impairments to demand across different major cities stemming from this work from home trend. However, there will be differences city by city by city. And you can see that just in and of the utilization rates that you're seeing. Paris is back up to about 75%. Seattle is somewhere 25 to 30%. Huge differences across the board. And that, underwriting that ultimate impairment or no impairment whatsoever, I think is going to be key in order to be able to find value for office real estate in the global markets.